building quite a few models for our museum exhibit. How do modelings play a role here in the laboratory for you?
Well, modelings are critically important for anything that scientists do, because the things that we're modeling are things that we can't actually see. And if we're going to have an idea of how they're going to behave, we have to have a way of thinking about them, of actually seeing what's going to happen. And since we can't really see them, the model is the only thing that we can really put in our mind and say, gee, that's how it might work.
Well, let's put Jeff on the spot. Jeff, I'm sure everybody would like to see an experiment showing us levitation. Can we do that here?
We sure can.
Well, let's get started.
Okay.
What do we have here?
Okay, we have here a couple of pieces of the new superconducting material that were developed in this lab and at the University of Alabama.
Doesn't look like much. Looks just like a little black disc.
Yeah, well, it is just an ordinary material. Well, it seems like an ordinary material to the eye, anyway. It's quite dark. And it doesn't have any properties of superconducting yet because it's not been cooled. There's no attraction or repulsion. Here.
Yeah, I can see that.
Yeah,
it's not doing anything. It's just laying on top of the material.
Yeah.
It's just sitting there.
Yeah, that's because it's at room temperature now. So we do have to cool it off. Not as cool as before this discovery, but
how are we going to cool this down?
Well, we'll cool it off with some liquid nitrogen.
Whoa, let's see this stuff.
Okay, yeah.
Whoa, Jeff, it smokes.
Yes, it does.
Did you see? Whoa, that is really cold.
It sure is.
How cold is that stuff?
This is less than 300 degrees or minus 300 degrees Fahrenheit.
Whoa, that is really cold. Let's see what it does.
Okay. What we'll do is we'll start to pour it, and you'll see some vapors coming out.
There's vapors coming off of the, even before it's pouring.
Yeah.
Whoa, it's really smoking up a storm now.
Okay.
How long do we have to wait now, Jeff, before we can levitate something?
Oh, I don't think we have to wait much longer at all.
Here comes some more nitrogen.
Just a little more nitrogen, and I think we'll cool that off, and it will be down to its superconducting transition temperature in just a moment.
Oh, that's really ice cold.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, what do we got?
Okay, now we just take our ordinary magnet, and we'll put it over the superconductor. Now, before it was just like this one, which is still at room temperature. There's just nothing happening there at all, okay?
Nothing at all, you're right.
But now the superconducting material is going to mirror this magnet, okay? And that will cause a repulsion.
There it is. It is actually above the disc.
Floating freely.
Oh, now listen, Jeff, you know, I know your name's Jeff, but could it be Houdini? Can you prove to me that this thing is really not just a magician's trick?
Yes, I think I can. I'll pass this wire over it and show you that there's nothing holding it. Okay. You see, I can pass this wire around it in any direction I want.
That is something else. It actually is levitating above that disc.
There's nothing here, yeah.
That is fantastic. Let me give it a try.
Isn't that great? Okay.
Yeah, there we go.
It's a beautiful principle, and it's just fascinating to watch.
Well, how much is the liquid nitrogen?
Liquid nitrogen is very cheap. As a matter of fact, for industry can buy liquid nitrogen at a price less than the price that you can buy milk in the grocery store.
Well, yeah, but we're not going to go to the grocery store and buy a quart of liquid nitrogen now, are we?
Well, not yet, but
someday we
may in the future.
Well, listen, Jeff, this was an exciting experiment. Thanks a lot for coming on to the show.
Oh, you're welcome.
I really appreciate the time you spent with us. Well, superconductivity sure sounds like the wave of the future, but we're still back in the steam age here in the workshop. Bill, how's the rocket coming along?
Well, Mike, I'm smoking along on this rocket. What we're doing now is highlighting with dry brushing some of these black parts to make them look more like real metal.
Okay, well, how are you going to do that?
Okay, we're going to take some kind of silver material. Now we can use the rub and buff wax, comes in a tube. We can use our regular silver paint, or we can use this silver buffing powder.
Now you never had this here before. What are we going to do with that?
Okay, we just put some of the buffing powder right on the brush.
Oh, it is dry, isn't it?
It's very dry. And it'll give a metallic effect.
Ah, I see, you're right.
To this black piece of the firebox when we paint over it.
Can we put it on the top too?
Sure.
Let me have a try at that, Bill. This looks really interesting. Now what do? Just dip it in the
just take a little bit of the silver powder.
Off the side of the jar maybe?
Right.
And right back on the card.
Yeah, tip it off a little on the card so you don't, that first stroke won't make the whole thing silver.
Okay, and then I just drag it across?
That's exactly it. Yeah, you can get a little there. You go and see how that pops that detail right out.
Yeah, you know you're right. Bill, why do we even bother with this stuff? I mean, is it important to bring the detail up on this?
Well, this kit's molded very nicely, Mike, and it's got a lot of rivets and a lot of highlights that we want to show. And the dark black paint will cover it all up on the finished product. If you don't have your seams done right,
like two pieces there
on these cylinder boxes.
What are you going to show me here?
Now here, when we dry brush over here, we pick up the high points.
Okay. What'd you blow on that for?
I just wanted to get some of the powder off. Now on this one, I left the seam unfinished. And you see how that pops out our seam?
Boy, it sure does. Now how would you take care of that?
Well, what we'd have to do is sand that seam back down again, paint this part black all over, and then dry brush the edges again to pop out the detail that we want to show. We don't want our mistakes to show.
Wow, this is really interesting. Bill, what other fine details does this kit entail?
Well, we've got a lot of small parts, and we've got some moving parts also, Mike.
Okay.
The firebox moves the drive shaft, and that connects to the driving wheel.
What do you have there? The driving wheel?
I've got the driving wheel for you.
Okay.
And the drive shaft.
So I just pop this right on?
Yeah, pop that on and see what we've got. And
okay.
Then we can...
All right, Bill, I'm having a problem. I can't seem to pop it on.
Okay.
What am I going to do here?
You found out, Mike, that kits don't always fit exactly the way they're supposed to.
So we have a problem here.
Yeah, particularly after you've put a few layers of paint on, you might not have a part that fits too well.
So what are you going to do to take care of this problem?
The easiest thing to do in this situation, Mike, is to take the hole on this piece and enlarge it a little.
All right, what are you going to use, a modeling knife or a saw or what?
We can use the blade of our modeling knife and twist it.
Oh, that is really interesting. Bill, where do you pick up all these tips at?
Well, Mike, I'm a member of the International Plastic Modelers Society.
Okay, and what does that entail?
Here we've got the file. Can ream that out.
Oh, you're reaming it out with a file.
And Plastic Modelers Society is an organization consisting of about 160 clubs around the country and a national organization. And it's all plastic modelers. It's a volunteer organization. You join the national society and you can get the membership journals. And you can join your local club, and interaction with the other modelers, meeting them and finding out how they do things is the best way for you to learn.
Well, this is great. Now, Bill, does your IPMS people show you what to do with this particular situation? We have to glue this thing on here, but
okay.
It has to move at the same time. How do we get around that problem?
All right, we've got a very small part here, Mike, that's going to pin the shaft on so that it won't come off later.
All right. Now, what happens
here?
If
we use our regular glue brush, you can see that it's way too big, and we're going to get much too much glue on that piece.
All right, what do we do?
So, we'll resort to the trusty tube glue.
Okay. What are we going to do here?
We'll put a little...
But that's still... The shaft of the tube glue is still way too big.
That's
to
right,
put on
Mike.
There.
So what we're going to do is apply the glue with a tool, in this case, just a simple toothpick.
Well, this certainly shows some ingenuity.
A little drop. And hopefully we can get it right down in that hole without touching the edges. Sort of like playing Operation, you know, when you were a kid.
Yeah, yeah.
But you don't get the buzzer to light up.
Oh.
And now with the glue in there.
Well, if you make a mistake, I'll buzz.
Okay.
All right, let's get it on there.
And just glue that on. And you can see, it's still moving, so we haven't glued it up too badly.
Yeah, it does move around real nice. And it hasn't been glued. Now, here's a great tip. Since we have toothpicks laying around the house, a toothpick has really become a very invaluable tool here. Bill, that is a great tip. The IPMS people really teach you well.
Well, we try to help out everybody, and it's good to get all the plastic modelers together. So you can write to our office in Lincoln, Nebraska, or look for your local chapter around your area.
Ah, I see what you're saying. Okay, Bill, what other finishing techniques or weathering techniques can you show me on the rocket?
Okay, now, once again, we're going to go back to some more dry brushing, Mike, but this time we're going to use a different material.
All right, looks like you have a piece of chalk.
Right, I've got a piece of pastel chalk here.
All right.
And this one I picked up at a flea market for about a quarter. I mean, you don't have to buy a whole artist set of chalks if you buy some gray and some brown.
You're just scraping that off there with the modeling knife.
Right, we'll just scrape some off.
Let me see how much you have in there.
If you pick that up, you can see we've got the chalk powder right in here.
It looks like paprika.
Well, this color does.
All right, what are you going to do with this?
Okay, we're going to take another brush and fill that up.
Okay.
And this will be sort of our final dusty dirt coat on the model.
All right, you have the tender of the thing there.
Got some of the pieces of the tender, and we'll brush some of this dust into the corners and into the grooves, into the red paint there.
Now, what do you keep blowing on this stuff? Where are you blowing it to?
We're blowing it around your workshop, but it'll settle down pretty soon. And you see, the chalk is an abrasive, and it'll actually rub into the paint if you rub it in.
Now, can we use any of this particular techniques on any other models?
Well, Mike, almost all of these modeling techniques are good for any number of models. You might want to build a model of a truck that's all dusty. You could use this technique. You might want to highlight the panel lines of an aircraft or a ship, and you could use this technique.
Let me give it a try. I think this ought to be fun. So, and as I run out of chalk, I just scrape more in there?
Just scrape more off, and, you know, you can make it as heavy or as light as you want. The
okay.
Same dry brushing techniques we use to highlight the metal pieces of the rocket here, we could use to accent landing gear parts on model airplanes.
Oh.
Or bring out the detail in a model car engine.
Yeah, you know, that's right, because they do get dusty and dirty, too. And I guess the more I put on here, the more use I'm showing.
Exactly.
Yeah, you know, this is a very, very easy technique to learn and to also apply.
If you go back to the silver and touch up those black metal pieces, you'll see the contrast there. See, now you've got your yellow wood pieces highlighted with the brown dirt, and that metallic silver should bring out the metal feel of the black wheel holder.
This is great. You know, I'll tell you, Bill, this takes a lot of patience and a lot of time to get this correctly done, but it certainly does pay off.
I hope so, Mike. Why don't you come over to the side bench with me, and I'll show you the finished product.
All right, I'm anxious to see it, because, you know, the finishing techniques that you just showed us here is great. What do you have for us over here?
Okay, here's the rocket with all the finishing techniques done.
Oh, let me take a close look at that one.
Yeah. See if we can give it to you.
All right. You got the track and the rail there. Look at this. You have the pipes all finely detailed and the wheels are perfect. Look at the dirt inside the tender there. That's perfect. Bill, you did a fantastic job. This will make a beautiful addition to the transportation exhibit upstairs. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Mike. It was my pleasure doing it.
Detail given to the early locomotives was stunning, and as you can see, our model, the Stephenson's rocket, captured that detail with great accuracy. The railroads were one of the earliest forms of mass transportation. However, with the advent of aviation, their role was greatly reduced, and the passenger train stations of the past became the modern airport terminals of today. On our next adventure in scale modeling, we're going to learn about architectural design, and we're going to build upon our modeling skills as we construct a modern airport terminal. So, we'll see you next time on Adventures in Scale Modeling.
Adventures in Scale Modeling is made possible through funding by the Tester Corporation, manufacturer of hobby products for over 50 years.